when I was praying, even this way today, usually when I'm driving to here, I'm praying the whole way. I don't have the radio on. I'm like, I want to focus. And so I'm praying and I'm asking God for specific things, and it just depends. Today it was, Lord, I was really celebrating for the first time in a long time the fact that we don't do things really polished, although we're getting pretty good at it. We don't, it's not a high value of ours, if I could say it that way. Not because we don't like it when things go smoothly, believe me, we do, but because I don't like it mattering so much that other things pay the price, if I could say it that way. And so I was just like, Lord, thank you that we can do things well without them having to be perfect, and that when things get bumpy or not quite right, that you, those are opportunities for you to do things that you wouldn't have done if everything had gone smoothly. So I don't know if God's preparing us for bumpiness in the sermon. I don't know if we've already had some, you know, we were having trouble with the mic before the service, and, you know, it's just bumpy stuff. It's a potential distraction. And I just want to say, you know, I don't want to apologize for that as much as I want to say, you know, I believe God can work in all ways and through all things. And so I hope that when you pray for us in this service each week, that you're praying that more importantly than everything goes smoothly and well, that everything would go as God would have it, and that even if it's a train wreck of a service, that just as long as God shows up, right? I mean, if the power goes out, I mean, we'll be able to hear better, because even though the sound system will be off, we won't have that humming and that air-conditioned sound, and it'll be really dark. But you know what I'm saying? It would be okay. We'd probably find some candles, and it would really be, we'd be like, oh, that was the greatest service ever. You remember the time when? So maybe we'll throw the breaker sometime and not tell you. I don't know. Kumbaya, right? All right. So I missed you guys last week. Anita and I did. We got to go to church with Kelsey and Ethan. Kelsey's our oldest in Atlanta. And we got the tour of Chick-fil-A corporate like times three or four buildings. It was epic. And we were walking down the hall. And it's Friday afternoon. Chick-fil-A corporate is like nobody there. I mean, there's like normally thousands of people there. And it was like 12. And so we're walking down this corridor in this kitchen, giant building that's just, they're inventing food, I guess. And this guy pops out, and he recognizes Kelsey, and he says, and he's got these drinks in his hand, and it's like, it looks like Hawaii on ice is what it looks like. And he's like, hey, y'all want to try these? We're trying these. We're going to roll these out this summer. And it's like, I don't know if I can get the name. I don't know what the name official is, but it's a passion strawberry lemonade sweet tea, or tea. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. So I got one. It was great. Oh, it was great. But I mean, I almost say magical time. We were kind of comparing it to Disney World because we saw where all the magic happens behind the grill. So all my Chick-fil-A friends are chuckling and laughing at me. I'm silly. All right. So, but I got to see them. I got to go to church with them. That was why we weren't here. We made the decision late to stay over, and they go to a little bitty church. And I say little bitty because they have about as many as we do. And they meet in an old brick church that they bought. This church is 3.5 years old in an old rundown neighborhood. And it's a young, diverse church. It's beautiful. It was beautiful. We were the minority. And it was just awesome. It was just a great feel. The spirit of the church was sweet. The people were friendly, and everybody was greeting everybody. And they didn't rush through the service, and it wasn't smooth or polished or any of the, you know, it made me think of us a few years ago in a lot of ways, but it was just really great. And so I just was grateful that Ken was willing and able to get up here and preach the next message in Ecclesiastes. I'm glad you get to hear from him, because he has so many great and wise insights that I miss almost all the time. But it was just really awesome to be able to be with them and see them. That's the first time we've gotten to see them since they moved out there last August. So they're doing well, and send their greetings to you. So I lived in Columbia, South Carolina back in the 70s when I was in elementary and middle school. And one of the things I remember about, I actually picture it happening in Summerville, because in my ninth grade, we moved to Summerville. And I remember we had a round table next to my dad's old Lazy Boy. And on that table was a little a pipe holder, you know, like the pipes you smoke. And my dad had, I don't know how many pipes, and it held like 6 pipes, and it had a little jar for fresh tobacco. And once in a while, he'd pull it out and he'd smoke his pipe. And whenever he did that, because it wasn't very often, whenever he did that, I'd always try to get him to blow a ring. You know how? Like a donut, smoke donut. Because I always thought, you know, the cartoons could do it. I thought, you know, my dad can do anything, so I'm going to get, and he was always just a blob of smoke. He never could quite get the ring going on. And so I chuckle when I watch movies like Lord of the Rings, when Bilbo's sitting next to Gandalf the Wizard, and Bilbo, they're smoking weed in their pipe. I don't know what kind of weed they're smoking, but they're having a good time. And he blows this huge ring. And then Gandalf, not to be outdone, he blows a smoke of a clipper ship, and the clipper ship sails through the ring and blows it apart. And I just thought that was, you know, it's all CGI and everything, but I think of those two things because they have something in common. In both cases, the smoke lasts about 3 or 4 seconds. And as we go through Ecclesiastes, the word that continues to pop up over and over and over is the Hebrew word hevel, which means smoke. It means meaningless. It means vanity of vanities. It means it's pointless. It means temporary and elusive. And the whole point of the book of Ecclesiastes is this character that the author has written in called the teacher or the preacher. This character keeps saying over and over and over, if this is all there is, then it's all just smoke. It's not going to last. It's elusive and temporary, and you're not going to be satisfied in life if you live in that with that mindset. And so he's been taking us on this quest that he went on, and he's kind of telling the story, if you will. He's playing the slides of life, and he's showing all the different ways in life where he's explored his ways of trying to find great satisfaction and meaning in life, and how everything, thing after thing after thing, has failed to do that. So last week it was religion, which, you know, I don't know that anybody sees that one coming. Here we have the king of Israel saying religion is just smoke if this is all there is. And yet, religion apart from God is just a waste, and it is pointless. Well, this week he hits in a spot that will make you squirm, let me tell you. And that is money and possessions. He says, if this is all there is, then that too is just hevel. Money and possessions is just smoke. So today, the sermon title is a question. And the question is this. It's how do we view and handle money and possessions? How do we handle it in light of hevel, in light of what we're reading here in Ecclesiastes? And my bottom line point is this. Instead of pursuing money and possessions for satisfaction, how about we pursue God and His gifts for ultimate satisfaction? Let me say it again. Instead of pursuing money and possessions for ultimate satisfaction, how about we pursue God and His gifts for that satisfaction? And so with that, we're going to jump in. We're going to be looking at chapter 5, starting in verse 8, and we're going to go through the end of chapter 6, which is a really short chapter. But we'll cover a lot of ground, and it won't necessarily be quick. But what we're basically going to see is he's going to say this in two, he's going to kind of make two major points. So if you're taking notes, this would be Roman numeral 1 and Roman numeral 2. Roman numeral 1 would be, you know, 7 reasons not to pursue money and possessions, not to make them your pursuit. 7 reasons for that. And the second one is going to be antidotes for that temptation. Antidotes to the temptation to pursue money and treasures. Okay? And so with that, let's jump in, starting in verse 8. Now, we've just come out of this part 1 through 7 where he's talked about religion is meaningless, is pointless, it's smoke, apart from if this is all there is in this cursed world. Now, he's going to start transitioning, and he's going to start broad. He's going to go to looking at money and wealth on a macro scale, and a systemic scale. He's going to look at what almost looks like a political scale. And in 2 verses, he's going to sum up what government is like in our nation, in our world, and the systems that are there. So here we go, 8 and 9 say this. The teacher writes, "If you see the poor oppressed in a district and justice and rights denied, do not be surprised at such things. For one official is eyed by a higher one, and over them both are others higher still. The increase from the land is taken by all. The king himself profits from the fields." And I don't think that's news to anybody. We know that people who are in power not only get paid a lot, but they have opportunities that come across their desk that they can take advantage of financially, some of them legitimately and some of them not. And what sometimes happens is those who are poor, those injustices can occur. A certain law can go a certain way, in such a way that hurts the least, the last, the lost, but they profit from it. That happens. And he's just stating something that he's seen happen. This is the king of Israel. And at this time, the most powerful nation in the world, most likely, certainly the wealthiest nation in the world at this time. And he knows this happens. And maybe he's even been a part of it. So he takes that as the top of the funnel, but he quickly goes from there to making it very personal. And this is where the seven, I will call them the seven reasons not to pursue money, and or the seven that he gives. And really, the first one might not even be the first one. The first one actually might be, like a summary of it. It's really a proverb. The writers that are smarter than me, these biblical scholars, say that it's actually a proverb in verse 10. It made me think of other passages and other places that we're going to go to as well. So verse 10 says, "Whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. This too is meaningless smoke." So this proverb made me think of, okay, because it says love, if you love wealth, if you love money, it's never going to satisfy. You're always going to want just a little bit more. It made me think of a couple of quotes that I found this week. One was, I've heard it before, J.D. Rockefeller. Some of you have no idea who that is. He was the wealthiest man in the world at the time when he was asked, "So how much money is enough?" And his answer was, "Just a little bit more." So I thought, what's a more contemporary quote that some of our younger people might know? You might have heard of Homer Simpson. And he said to his boss, "You must be the richest guy I know." And he goes, "Yeah, but I'd trade it all for a little bit more." That's the mindset of many people in our world today. But here's what's going to bother you a little bit. I hope it does. When Paul talks about it, he writes about it as if it's not just a problem in the world, it's a problem in the church. Because he writes to Timothy, who's leading the church in Ephesus, and he's basically saying, teach those folks this about money, because they're not getting it. So hold your finger here, flip to the right in the New Testament to 1 Timothy 6. We're going to do this quickly because we really don't have time to do it, but I think it's too spot on for us to ignore. It's near the end of one of Paul's last letters to anybody, but to Timothy in particular. His last letter he writes is 2 Timothy. There may have been one in between. I don't think so, unless it was to Titus. That might have been in between. So verse 6 through 10, I want you to listen to this, and then when we go back to Ecclesiastes and even Job, we're going to look at Job 1:21 also. This is what Paul writes to Timothy. He says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." And if you remember in Ecclesiastes, there's several times when the teacher or the preacher talks about gain and profit and what does or doesn't gain or profit us. He's talking about what's great gain right here. Godliness plus contentment. And of course, Paul says in somewhere else in the Bible, I don't even remember where, he says, "I've been with much and I've been without anything and I've learned to be content in all things," something to that effect. But verse 7 says, "For we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that." And I thought, ooh, I wish I could say that. I mean, I'm supposed to say that. I'm sorry, I'm the preacher. Yeah, I would be content with that. You could feed me anything from the grocery aisle. It could be generic food. I would be okay with that. Yes, I would wear anything. Doesn't matter what label it's on. I wish I could say that to you in good conscience. But you know what? I probably wouldn't be. Because I have my preferences and my favorites. But he says,
He says, but if we have those things, we will be content with that. Those in Christ, those pursuing God, not pursuing those things. Verse 9, those who want to get rich. Now remember, he's talking to the church. Those who want to get rich, parentheses, in the church, us, those who want to get rich fall into temptation. Warning, warning, Will Robinson. And the trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. That sounds horrible. Ruin, destruction. That sounds kind of permanent too. That sounds really, really painful. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Here, don't hear what it doesn't say. It doesn't say that money is the root of all evil. It doesn't say that. It says the love of money. You could even say the pursuit of, above all else, money. And of course, Jesus speaks to this in Matthew 6, and I'll speak to that in a little bit. And then he says, some people eager for money, again, Christians or people in the church even, it could be non-Christians in the church, some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm a Christian and I care at all about money, these should be warning flags. Red and yellow flags should be going off. And I should be evaluating my life immediately. I should be like, am I that person? Now, before you go back to Ecclesiastes, flip back past Ecclesiastes, past the Psalms to the left, at least in certain Bibles. Job 121, Job says this. Remember, Job goes from having an incredible estate and business to, he goes from basically being like wealthy like Bill Gates to being like the guy under the bridge. Job 121 says, I don't think I gave this to the guys in the back, I apologize. Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. There's somebody who had a lot of money, but did not pursue it at the expense of his God. This would have been ancient worship. This is way, way back. This is may even be pre-Abraham. We're talking somebody who didn't have the benefit of the cross, didn't have the benefit of the scriptures, and yet pursued God, his creator, above possessions and money. Okay, so back to Ecclesiastes. Now, let's get into the list a little bit, and we're going to move a little quicker now. Verse 11, this is another reason not to pursue money and possessions. Okay, as goods increase, so do those who consume them. And what benefit are they to the owners except to feast their eyes on them? When you make more money, you draw more people who have a handout. Okay, think of people who win the lottery, right? And you hear all the stories in the wake of that of how everybody's, you know, knocking on their door asking for a help or a donation or something. And so people don't even announce it when they won now. They go to an attorney and they do it in secret because they don't want people knocking on their door. I think of athletes who come from very, very poor neighborhoods and they make it to the NFL or the NBA or MLB and they've got these big contracts. And all of a sudden, all these people hang around them. They've got this entourage of people who are just looking for their piece of the pie. Even when you make more money, your government even wants more of it, right? You're in a higher tax bracket, more higher percentage. All of that is just to say, as goods increase, so do those who consume them. Even when your family, you have your family, you're on a tight budget, and all of a sudden, somebody comes home with a bonus or a raise, or we just had a big payment come in or something, and all of a sudden, we're going out to eat and we're going to go shopping. And I get it, that makes sense sometimes, but it's just, this doesn't mean that it can't be a legitimate thing. It still is true, as goods increase, so do those who consume them. The next one is verse 13. I have seen a grievous sin, I'm sorry, I skipped one. Verse 12, the sleep of a laborer is sweet, whether they eat little or much. So it doesn't matter if they have a lot or not, they sleep well at night. Someone who works hard, brings home that check. But as for the rich, their abundance permits them no sleep. And I can think of a time when I don't put myself in this category, but I do think this has happened to us more than once. I remember Kelsey was she wasn't even 2 years old yet. We were living in Tampa at the time, and Kelsey was one. She had just started walking. Maybe it was a little later, but at some point we were thinking about number two. Maybe she was expecting, Anita was expecting, and we decided we were going to get a video camera. Now, this was back when video cameras were the size of trucks, but there was a new one out called a Handycam, Sony Handycam. It was small, you could hold it in your hand, and it didn't make you tip over. And so I was like, I really want to get one of those because, you know, you can justify that with one on the way, right? So so we went to Circuit City. You may have heard of that. It's an antique store. And you went to Circuit City, and they had this deal where you could buy anything, 30 days, return, no questions asked. So I'm like, okay, I don't know anything about it. I may not even be able to drive this thing. Let's try it. And unusually, Anita is very frugal and very good with our money, and she keeps me talks me off the ledge a lot of times and buying things we shouldn't buy. I don't know if she was having a bad day or if she really was all for this. I don't really know. At least that day, we got home, we unpacked it, we actually started shooting video immediately, so I have a little bit of footage of Kelsey when she's one, and then she gets buyer's remorse big time. So the camera goes back the next day, and we both slept really well the second night. But that's kind of the thing. When you have more stuff, you start to think about all the things that could go wrong or all the things that need to be fixed or all the insurance I need to buy. My brother, he always wanted a really nice car, and he had this old beat-up pickup truck he's driven for years, and he decided he was going to lease a Porsche. Or Porsche. I'm sorry. I don't. And this car was so expensive to lease that he bought insurance for the rims. You know, because you can scrape up against a curb and trash a rim. He had to buy insurance because he was afraid that might happen. And I'm thinking, wow, I would have never thought there was insurance for something like that. And so that's kind of a picture of this, that our things can begin to own us instead of us own our things. And that sleep, hard to sleep at night because of all the things that could go wrong. Oh, goodness, I need to update the flood insurance. Oh, wait a minute, we don't have flood insurance. Should we have flood insurance? And the anguish that goes with all those things. Should I get a maintenance plan for my AC? Is it too late? Is it time for a roof? Should we get solar power? All these complicated things that you think about. And he says, they don't get sleep. And then there's the next verse. I've seen a grievous evil under the sun. Wealth hoarded to the harm of its owners. And I don't know what that's like. Just don't look at my garage. You know? There's a fine line between storing things that you might need and actually really need and just keeping stuff because you're afraid. I don't really know the mentality that goes through the mind of someone who's, quote, a hoarder. I don't know. My grandfather kept everything because he grew up, he had a farm during the Depression. My dad was born right during the Depression, and he was the youngest in the family. So we would go, and I remember going through his barns. His barns didn't even have doors. They really didn't have much. And he'd have a can of nails, and I'd look in the can, and these nails were all rusty, bent, or broken. There wasn't a straight one in the can. I'm like, why does he keep these? And my dad's like, you don't understand. He might need them. And he doesn't have the, that you would need to just go out and buy another box of nails. And so if he tore something down, he pulled every single nail out and threw it in the can. He had another container of broken straps of leather. Like some of those pieces of leather was like a piece of a shoelace this long made of rawhide. He kept it because he might need it. Now, I think in his case it was legitimate. I think he was just, I've got the space, I'm on a farm, I'm always needing things, and that's one less dime I have to spend. But it can go to a place where it creates harm. And I don't pretend to understand this or know how it affects us. I'm just telling you, wealth hoarded to the harm of its owner is right there in verse 13. But it continues. Another reason is, or wealth lost through some misfortune, so that when they have children, there's nothing left for them to inherit. So in Israel's history, one of the big things that was real important for dads to do was to make sure that they left an inheritance for their kids, because it wasn't a luxury to get a big check when someone passed away. It was like survival. So the family business needed that influx of cash, plus you're dividing at times, always, if ever possible, large families. So it wasn't like there was a whole lot going to anybody. But there was land, which was, of course, you're talking promised land days. You're talking precious family land. But then there's the parts of the business, and there's just whatever heirlooms and other valuables that are in there. If you remember the woman who poured the expensive nard all over Jesus and got, you know, fussed at for something so valuable, many commentators think she got that as an inheritance. So this is a big deal. And this, because of misfortune, this wealth evaporated, and this father, this dad, was not able to pass on to his kids an inheritance. Things happen that we don't have control over in our world. And we've experienced that. If you've been around since 2008, you've seen that. We've lived through it. And of course, there have been other times when we've had that happen in our nation too. Those things happen. They're beyond our control. And it's one of the reasons why we shouldn't pursue wealth and money and all those things at the exclusion of everything else. It's keeping it in the right perspective. Verse 15 and 16 say this: everyone comes naked from their mother's womb. And everyone comes, so they depart. Sound familiar? We read it in 1 Timothy, and we also read it in Job. They take nothing from their toil that they can carry in their hands. Randy Alcorn says it this way in his book, The Treasure Principle. He says, and this is the treasure principle that the book is written around, you can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead. And he's talking about your wealth, your money, whatever you possess. You can't take it with you. You die, it's still here, and you're gone. There's no U-Haul trailers behind hearses in those funeral processions. You never see a U-Haul. Well, I don't know if never, but, right, what's the point? Right? Think of the Egyptian kings who were buried with their treasure, and so people want to dig them up because they want their treasure, because it's still there. So it's important for us to realize that, and I think sometimes we get our heads down and we don't remember that. Okay, you can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead. I'll talk about that part later. All right, so... So he finishes up with that, and so that's that. Those reasons for not pursuing it. Now, here's some antidotes. There's really just three antidotes. I'm only going to focus on two because of time. But the first one, so the antidotes are, these are antidotes for the temptation to pursue money and riches, money and wealth over for your ultimate satisfaction. Instead, we want to pursue God and his gifts. And if you notice, usually we would say pursue God. We wouldn't usually throw in and his gifts. But here's what's important to understand. God's not against material wealth. God's not against money. He wants us to pursue him and let him take care of that, however he chooses to do that. And there's a host of factors that influence that. But if I'm pursuing him and that's my focus, then I don't have to worry about that stuff. I mean, I have to think about it. I have to deal with it. I have to pay my taxes. I have to balance my books. I should run a budget. But I don't have to be consumed with the pursuit of more and more and more, because more is never enough. So the first one, there's the three antidotes. Number one antidote is redemptive relationships. Redemptive relationships. Number two is contentment and joy in what you already have. So the first one is redemptive relationships. The second one is contentment and joy in what you already have. And the third is God. Okay? So let me do the relationship one real quick, because we've already talked about chapter 4, 7 through 12. Right? Two are better than one. A cord with three strands is not easily broken. That is all about good relationships. Okay? I want to add one little piece to it. Okay, so when we talk about relationships, you're basically talking about family and friends and those that are becoming family or friends, okay? Not all relationships are equal. So you can look at this two ways. One is, am I being this kind of person to others? And you can look at this, am I spending the bulk of my time with people who are either pointing me towards Christ's likeness, spurring me towards Christ's likeness, or they're someone God has in my crosshairs to bless in that way? In other words, I'm pointing them that way. Persons of peace, they don't have to be believers to do that. Okay, so people in my life. Or am I surrounding myself with people that are tearing me down, pulling me down, keeping me away from what really matters? So I would just say that is a huge antidote to this pursuit, as long as those relationships are redemptive. Redemptive meaning they're helping you buy back, in the sense of they're helping you redeem the time that God has given you, and so that you steward everything he's given you well. Okay, number two, contentment and joy in what God's already given us. Let's look at verse 18, 19, and 20. Let me read that to you. This is how he wraps up chapter 5. The teacher writes, "This is what I have observed to be good." So he's like kind of a summary statement here. This is what I think is good. "That it is appropriate for a person to eat, to drink, and to find satisfaction in their toilsome labor under the sun during the few days of life God has given them, for this is their lot. Moreover, when God gives someone wealth and possessions and the ability to enjoy them, to accept their lot and be happy in their toil, this is a gift from God. They seldom reflect on the days of their life because God keeps them occupied with gladness of heart. So as I was thinking through this and just kind of how I wanted to remember this, I kind of came up with this expanding sentence that I kept coming back to. So what the couple of scriptures that came up before I say this, one is Psalm 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. That's foundational. If you don't believe that, then you're going to have issues with this whole message. Because if you don't believe that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, then you actually believe you really own what you have. And while you legally have ownership of it, if you're in Christ, it's not yours. You were given it, and it can be taken away like that. Just ask Job. Okay? We are stewards. Life is a stewardship. It's temporary, and you're accountable. Let me say that again. Life is a stewardship. It's temporary, and you're accountable. I'm accountable for how I spend my life, how I spend my time, talent, treasure, testimony, and temple. That's my body. How I spend those things is a stewardship, and I'm either good at it or I'm not. But God has given me those things to steward, expecting a return on his investment, and the investment is into the kingdom. Okay? So I can just continue with that. Here's this expanding sentence. So God, he says, what is good? So I would say, what is good? I want to, with him. What is good? God's gifts. What is good? The ability to enjoy God's gifts. What is good? The ability to enjoy God's gifts with others. There's relationships. What is good? The ability to enjoy God's gifts with others fully content. That's the tranquility that he refers to in 4:6. Ecclesiastes 4:6, I'm sorry, yeah, says this: better one handful with tranquility than two handfuls with toil, a chasing after the wind. Talking about the person who's all their pursuits are climbing that ladder, more, more, more. I just got to earn more. All right, so now that's two of our big three sections. The last section is where we are now, the third antidote, which is God. Okay, so the first one was relationships, redemptive relationships. The second one was contentment and joy in the things God's already given us. And the last one is God, and that's the super, that's the silver bullet, right? I mean, if we are walking in God's footsteps in his way, then we're going to have the right perspective. Verses 10, 11, and 12. So we're going to wrap it up here. So these verses are a little difficult, I think, to understand. What I've learned is that it seems to be pointing back to the creation account. So we're pointing back to Genesis 1 and 2 and 3, which is where God creates the heavens and the earth, Genesis 1 and 2, all right? And he says it's good or very good. And the only thing in those first three chapters God says is not good is that man would be alone. He knew we needed women, so he saved the world and created women, right? And then we have the fall, okay? In those first two chapters, Adam spends time naming the animals. Remember, he's looking through the animals. God's God. He's parading them by. He's naming all the animals, looking for a suitable helper. Can't find one. That's why God creates woman from his rib. Okay? And then we have this drama that unfolds in chapter 3 where Adam and Eve are tempted to basically contend with God, to disagree with God, to go against his clear mandate to not eat from the fruit of the tree, to not eat from the fruit on the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Don't eat. The only rule in this, and you have all the provision you could ask for, everything you could want, total, complete, ultimate satisfaction available. You're walking daily with your Creator and having conversations, I imagine, in such a way they could see God, I imagine, I don't know that, and there's this beautiful created account. There's no death. There's no hint of death until they disobey the one command. Now, in light of that, hear 10, 11, and 12. Whatever exists has already been named. Think about the animals. And what humanity is has been known. No one can contend with someone who is stronger, though Adam and Eve tried. The more the words, the less the meaning. And how does that profit anyone? For who knows what is good for a person in life? I think God does. God knows what satisfies. I think He knows. During the few and meaningless days they pass through like a shadow. Because now we have death, so we don't last very long. Who can tell them, who can tell people what will happen under the sun after they are gone? Again, I think God knows. And that's the point. Here's the thing that I guess that I would use to really chase this and drill down on this one. Back in the earlier part of 6, it referred to this more than, oh, I didn't read it. So 1 through 9, I missed it. Okay, but here's the point of 1 through 9. Let me read it, and then I'll explain it, and then we're done. Starting in verse 1. Maybe I'm supposed to end with this anyway. Verse 1, I've seen another evil under the sun, and it weighs heavily on mankind. God gives some people wealth, possessions, and honor, so that they lack nothing their hearts desire. But God does not grant them the ability to enjoy them. And strangers enjoy them instead. This is meaningless, a grievous evil. Now he's about to expand and tell you how evil he thinks this is, how terrible this is. This is going to be a difficult picture for some of you. God's grace as I read it. A man may have 100 children and live many years. Yet no matter how long he lives, if he cannot enjoy his prosperity and does not receive proper burial, I say that a stillborn child is better off than he. It comes without meaning, that's the child. It departs in darkness, and in darkness its name is shrouded. Though it never saw the sun or knew anything, it has more rest than does that man. Even if he lives 1,000 years twice over, but fails to enjoy his prosperity, do not all go to the same place? And then it continues. But the point here is found right here. Why in the world, I ask myself, why in the world would God bless somebody with all the wealth, possessions, riches, and honor that they would want, and then not also give them the ability to enjoy it? That seemed crazy to me on the surface. What are you doing? And then it hit me. Because there's something better. And the way God leads us to something better is by not giving us what we think is best. We do this with our kids all the time, don't we? Right? They want whatever, fill in the blank, the fourth ice cream cone. Please, 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 I'll love you forever. Fourth ice cream cone. And you're like, you know, this really isn't good for you. I know what's better for you. And, you know, you can trust me or not, but this is, you know. God does not give the people who pursue money and possessions. He gives them, in many cases, a lot of that, right? We look around, we see people who don't know the Lord, and we go, why is God blessing them with so much abundance? It doesn't make sense. But you see, here's what we don't know. They're miserable. Look at the first 7 reasons. They're experiencing them all. They're never satisfied because they're pursuing the love of money and wealth and honor. And God is not letting them enjoy it. He is keeping from them the one thing they need to enjoy, the thing they are pursuing. And he's saying, the reason I'm doing this is so you'll wake up and realize there's something better. And you'll pursue me instead. God and his gifts, they go together. That's why he does it. So when you're tempted to look at your neighbor and go, man, how many cars and boats is he going to buy? Maybe I could get some of his crumbs. I mean, I would be happy with just a little motorboat. I mean, just a little John boat with a motor on the back. I could go fishing. I mean, just one of those 3 boats in your backyard would be fine with me. Oh, man, can you believe the kids in my youth group? They all drive newer cars than me. I don't understand. Why is that possible? I'm not bitter, I promise. Okay, you see what I'm saying, though? Right? God knows what he's doing. and he's calling us to what's best for us. I mean, it makes sense that our Creator would know. Okay, so let me land the plane. So what do I think we do with this? I think we end with Matthew 6, 19 through 24. And I didn't give you guys this verse in the back. I'm sorry. Matthew 6, 9 through 24 says this. Jesus is speaking. He's speaking in his kingdom manifesto, the Sermon on the Mount, and he says to them, in the context of a lot of other rich passages, he says, do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth. Don't do it. Where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. Don't do it. It's unwise. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your money. He says, instead, store up. Wait, did you hear that? He does tell you to store up treasure. I don't think people believe that. Jesus said to store up treasure. But what does the rest of the verse say? Store up treasure in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your heart is, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So what is he saying? He's saying you can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead. The treasure principle says, I can't take the money I have here and now with me, but I can send it ahead in the form of rewards by investing in the one thing that matters to God. When I pursue God, that means I care about what he cares about. What does he care about? His glory. And what's his mission? His kingdom expansion. And what's the church about? We're the front lines of the advancement of the kingdom of God. So that's what we're to be about. And churches that do that make him smile. And people who give to churches like that make him smile. And it all works out. His economy trickles in whatever direction it needs to trickle to do what he wants to do in that way. Okay? Please, this is not about increasing your giving to Grace Christian Fellowship. Please don't let that derail you here. This has nothing to do with that other than that is a byproduct of it. But that is not the point he's making. The point Jesus is making is you're going to be incredibly more blessed when you live the way I designed you to live. And that is to live for me and my kingdom. Period. If you all started giving all your money to missionaries who were extending the kingdom in other countries, that might be a better way to spend your money. So it doesn't have to do with us. Okay? I'm not going to not talk about money and giving just because you might misunderstand me, but I'm going to make that clear. That is not the point. The point is that my satisfaction in life is directly tied to how I handle the money that he's given me to steward. And everything else, by the way. How I handle that matters. Okay? And so Jesus says, give it to a place where there's no risk of loss in your investment, and the return is 30 times, 60 times, or 100-fold. Okay, so if I told you that I could beat Charles Schwab because I don't have fees, there's absolutely no risk in you losing any money you put in, and the returns at least 30 times, would you be interested? I think so. And Jesus guarantees that. You just have to believe. You have to decide, do I really believe that there's something after this life and that the rewards will carry over? Because we're living in it now, we do it now, believing in something that will happen later, we believe. And that's what faith is. And that's the journey he's called us to. And I don't have any apologizes for preaching that or living that way. And I hope you do too. Let's pray.